Welcome back everybody to Pattern Recognition. So today we want to explore a bit more this concept of kernels, and we will look into something that is called the Mercer's Theorem. So looking forward to exploring kernel spaces. So let's have a look into kernels. So far we've seen that the linear decision boundaries in their current form have serious limitations. It's too simple to provide good decision boundaries. Non-linearly separable data cannot be classified. Noisy data cause problems. And also this formulation allows you to work with vectorial data only. So one possible solution that we already hinted at is mapping into a higher dimensional space using a nonlinear feature transform and then use a linear classifier. So we've seen that the SVM decision boundary can be rewritten in dual form, and then we could see that we essentially got rid of the actual normal vector and everything could be written as some over the Lagrange multipliers, the class observations, and the actual features. And in this particular optimization problem, we've seen that the feature vectors only appear as inner products. So the conclusion is that we only have inner products here. So this can be applied in both the learning and the classification phase. Now let's look again at this inner product in a bit of more detail. So we've seen that this was also the case in the perceptron, and there we've seen that essentially we were summing up over all the steps during the training procedure, and we already have seen that also in this case we essentially only had inner products for the decision boundary. And we've seen that we only need the observations that actually produced updates of our decision boundary during the training process. So this is the set E here, if you remember. So again, everything can be boiled down to inner products. We can use feature transforms now, and this feature transform phi is mapping from space D dimensional to a capital D dimensional space. And now the capital D is larger or equal to D, such that the resulting features are linearly separable. So let's look into one example. Here we have some original feature space that is centered around zero, and all the observations from one class are in the center, and all the observations from the outer class are outside aligned. And it's very clear that this example cannot be solved with a linear decision boundary. But now I take the feature transform phi equals to x1 square and x2 square, so this has exactly the same dimensionality, and what we see is by mapping onto essentially the squared dimensions, we can now find a linear decision boundary. Now this is a simple example. It may be more difficult, and it already gets difficult if we start using data that is not centered. In this case, if we apply our feature transform, we see that we are not able to separate these data linearly. But if we use a 3D transform that still includes, for example, x2, then you see that we can again find a linear decision boundary. So this is again the idea of using a polynomial feature transform in order to map to a higher dimensional space that then will allow us to use the linear decision boundaries. So we've seen that the decision boundary given by a quadratic function is obviously not linear, but because the parameters in A are linear, we can map this to this high dimensional feature space in order to get linear decision boundaries in this transformed high dimensional space. Now let's consider the distances in the transformed space. So I apply phi and I apply it to some x and some x prime and take the 2 norm. If we scratch this out, then you see this is the inner product of the two differences. And then we can essentially write this up, and you see that I get essentially only inner products. So the two norm of our transformed spaces can be written only by using inner products. So with this kind of feature transform, we can even evaluate distances only by the means of inner products. So this then also means that they can very easily be incorporated into our support vector machine. So the decision boundary is then given as the feature transformed vectors using the inner product, and also the optimization problem can be rewritten with this inner product. So we can integrate this quite easily also into the support vector machine. This then brings us to the notion of a kernel function. A kernel function that is mapping from two feature domains that are both identical, of course, x, to some value r that is a real value. And it needs to be a symmetric function that maps pairs of features to real numbers. And in this case, then the property holds that our k is given as the inner product of the feature transforms of the respective x and x prime for any mapping phi. So this is usually much easier to evaluate because we only need to have the inner products, and if we have a finite set of training observations, we can of course pre-compute those. And if you pre-compute those, this gives you the kernel matrix, and in the kernel matrix then you have all the elements that are essentially the inner products of the feature transforms. So all of these entries are similarity measures of the transformed feature pairs. This kernel matrix is positive semi-definite, and we can actually also show this. And we know that the property needs to be fulfilled for all x, that x transpose kx is greater or equal to zero. So let's start with this. We can rearrange this and write it as a sum. So we see that these are the entries of kij multiplied with xi xj. And then we see that the entry of k is simply the inner product of the feature transforms. And this then means that we can bring in also the xi and the xj into this transform. And you see here that the sum is a linear operation, so I can also bring in the sum into the respective inner products. Now you can see that this is an inner product of the respective sums, and this is essentially two times the same sum but with different indices, which then means that this can be rewritten as the average over xi times phi of xi, and this is a two norm, and the two norm is of course always greater or equal to zero. So we can easily show that this is really positive semi-definite. Let's look into typical kernel functions. There is the linear kernel that you've already seen. We've talked about the polynomial one. A new one that I want to suggest here is the Laplacian radial basis function, where we are essentially using e to the power of minus, and then not the two norm, but the one norm, and we divide by some standard deviation. Obviously, we can do something similar to Gaussians, where we then have the two norm, and we can also use sigmoid kernels using the hyperbolic tangent. And now the real question is, can we actually find for every kernel function a feature mapping phi such that the kernel function can be written as an inner product? So this is an important question for us, because only then we have this property with the inner product that we use so heavily. There is Mercer's theorem, and Mercer's theorem tells us that any symmetric function that maps a feature space, let's say x times x, so this is a function with two variables, to a real space, and that is square integrable on its domain, and satisfies this integral here, the integral over the whole domain of f of x times f of x prime times the kernel of x and x prime over x and x prime is greater or equal to zero for all square integratable functions f, there exists a phi I from x to r and lambda I greater zero, such that this kernel function k can be expressed as a sum over lambda i's and feature transforms phi I of x times phi I of x prime for all x and all x prime. Now this brings us to this kernel trick. In any algorithm that is formulated in terms of positive semi-definite kernels, we can derive an alternative algorithm by replacing the kernel function k by another positive semi-definite kernel k prime. So here we see the original feature space and we apply our feature transform, and this is our transformed feature space. So the kernel trick. And now in this transformed feature space, we have these very nice properties of being linearly separable. Let's look back at our kernel SVM with soft margins now. This is the linear kernel here, where the complexity parameter C controls the number of support vectors and hence the width of the margin and the orientation of the decision boundary. So you can see that here. And if we vary C, then you see that the number of support vectors is increased, and so also our decision boundary changes. Now we can apply the same idea in a polynomial space. And now if I project the polynomial decision boundaries and margins back into the original domain, you can see here how the decision boundary is actually displayed in the original data space. So you see here the polynomial kernel and the margins. Now if I decrease C, you can see how the margin area is increased. Of course, we can also use other kernels like the Gaussian radial basis function kernel here. And here you can see now that we get a decision boundary and our margins are essentially encircling the two classes here. So very interesting. And of course, we can then also color code the output of our decision boundary. And you see that at the zero level set, the actual decision boundary is. And we then also see that the one class here is then indicated in blue and the other class is indicated in red. Okay, so this was a short introduction into kernels and Mercer's theorem. And in the next video, we actually want to talk about further applications of kernels, and we want to introduce concepts like the kernel PCA. You remember, we could also write this up as inner products, so this can also be applied to general feature transforms. And we also want to talk about a couple of additional advanced kernels. So thank you very much for listening and looking forward to seeing you in the next video. Bye bye.